This will be a little bit of a different presentation. I'm not actually presenting a project, or it's not like completely technical, but it's more of a legal analysis of the decentralized technologies. So, as I said, I'm a legal researcher, and I'm focusing on the question of governance by design by focusing on decentralized architecture. And I'm looking at how those new decentralized architectures are interacting with the legal system. So, first of all, I think it's really important to differentiate between the concept of regulation by code and governance by design. So there is a lot of discussion in the legal world of how the internet is actually providing this new mechanism of regulation, which is regulation by code. And what I'm trying to look at instead is the question of governance by design by the communities. So the idea is that regulation by code is something that is really technologically deterministic. So we encode the rules, and the technology is going to enforce those rules as they are. Whereas in the concept of governance, this is a much more socially driven approach. It is a collaboration of all the actors that are being governed, that are deciding how the rules should be developed. And so we have this differentiation of the regulation by code, which is kind of this unilateral imposition by the technology that is then regulating the behavior of people, as opposed to something that is much more communitarian, and the rules of the technology are used in order to help the socially driven governance of the communities. So basically, the question is, we have those new technologies, and they enable new form of governance, which can be more decentralized, which can be more transparent, more flat, etc. And ideally, by relying on technology, we can now achieve a mechanism for large-scale collaboration that were not possible before. So, as well as, so one thing is, before we had communities, it is kind of easy to coordinate ourselves. The internet is providing this communication platform that everybody can communicate and organize themselves, but there is a point in which, when the community scales up, it becomes difficult, the coordination becomes more complicated, and therefore there are those new forms of hierarchy or centralized coordination that emerge. So the question is, can we actually rely on new decentralized technology in order to avoid this centralized traditional hierarchical structure to evolve, and instead to have decentralized large-scale collaboration? And so I've been involved for like the past, I don't know, 5 or 10 years in common-based peer production communities, which are communities such as, for instance, Creative Commons, the Open Knowledge Foundation, which are peer-to-peer oriented. So they try to avoid this hierarchy, and they try to create things which are for the common good, etc. And there is this one thing that we notice is that when the community is really small and everybody knows each other, it's really easy to deal with whatever. And then as the community grows, there are always tensions that emerge because these common-based peer production ideals is somehow gets less and less strong because the structure emerges. And this structure is the traditional centralized structure. Or when we actually want to maintain a decentralized structure, then oftentimes it relies on market-based mechanisms. So one thing that I started being really interested in when I was analyzing those possible technologies that could promote decentralized large-scale collaboration is the blockchain technologies. So the first one is obviously Bitcoin, which I guess everybody knows here, which has shown that it is, in fact, possible to coordinate ourselves and to create transactions in a trustless manner without having to rely on the centralized financial intermediaries. Now, of course, Bitcoin was just the beginning. Bitcoin has shown that there is this new technology, which is the blockchain, which is essentially this decentralized public ledger, which relies on cryptography, in order to make sure that every transaction that is done is a valid transaction. And over time, there is new applications that have been developed which rely on the same technologies, but which are not focusing on the concept of financial transaction or currency, but are trying to identify what other kind of use can we make of the blockchain? So I guess Ethereum is a really interesting example, which has taken the technology of the blockchain and instead of just focusing on those transactions, has created a programming language so that anyone can create those contractual transactions on top of the blockchain, which are automatically enforced by the code of the technology. There is a Swarm, which has developed, for instance, a crowdfunding platform, also based on the blockchain. So people can invest money into a project and they obtain some kind of equity or share or crypto equity into this project, which is all regulated through this trustless environment of the blockchain. So by the simple factor of donating to a project, I become a stakeholder, and these tokens which I own, I can then use them as form of privilege or like voting right, etc., in order to participate into the governance of the project that I have funded. And then Coinify is similar. So there is like more and more every day, there is like a new startups which is creating a new use of blockchain technologies in order to create decentralized organization and so on. So one thing that I think is really interesting is, in fact, when we abstract away from the blockchain as a simple technology for transaction, and we look at how it can enable new form of distributed collaborative organization. So it can allow people to collaborate with each other according to a particular set of rules which are encoded into the blockchain. And so this allows for communities to scale without having to rely on the traditional hierarchical structure, because the rules of the organization are completely transparent and they are specified by the blockchain and they cannot be changed. So as long as people are transacting with a particular contract on the blockchain, then they know exactly what will be the consequence, etc. And so by combining together those different smart contracts and alienating them, we can then create large-scale collaboration through the technology. And so the main concept of the main innovation of the blockchain beyond Bitcoin is this concept of smart contracts, which are those it's basically pieces of code which are deployed on the blockchain and which regulate the rules for a transaction. And those transactions, just like any pieces of code, will be automatically executed in a distributed manner by everyone that is connected to the network. And so it is possible to create transactions without having to know who is the person behind. In fact, the transaction can even be done with a computer or with a machine. And in a way that I don't need to trust the person I'm contracting with, because there is no way that the contract will be breached, since it is the technology that will enforce the contract. So as long as the individual have trust into the technology, then I don't need to trust the people I'm interacting with. And so the thing that I'm trying to explore is then how can the smart contract technologies and blockchain be used in order to enable new forms of governance by design for decentralized communities, and how they interact with the traditional concept of regulation by code. And most importantly, what is the interaction that happens when we start deploying those new technologies, which right now are completely, really emergent? And what is the impact they have on the legal system, and whether they can actually support the legal system, or whether they actually can modify it, or at least challenge it? And so, I think the most important thing is there is actually a lot of discussion in the legal field about the concept of smart contracts, and there is so much time that is being wasted on wondering whether a smart contract is actually an enforceable contract or a valid contract and whatnot. There's this really useful sentence which explains the picture here, which is that a smart contract is to a contract what a koala bear is to a bear, which essentially they share the name together, but they actually have nothing to do. So a smart contract is more flows to a simple, normal computer application than to a legal contract. The problem is that people, because it is called a smart contract, people often assume it is an actual legal contract and treat it as such. So it is, first of all, really important to distinguish between what is a legal contract, which is essentially just an agreement between two or more persons to do something in exchange of something else, and this agreement will be then enforceable under the law, but it is not self-enforced through the technology. Whereas the smart contract is a computer program which is automatically executed and therefore self-enforcing through the technological framework in which it is run. And so there is... 1 minute, okay. Well, there is two ways to use a smart contract. One is to actually support the law through the smart contract. So, for instance, in the case of digital rights management system, we have legal rules, we have copyright law, etc., and then we can use technology in order to somehow formalize those legal rules into technological rules that will be self-enforced, with, of course, all the difficulty of translating a legal norm into a technical law norm that is like in a formal language, etc. So this is like the legal rule exists, the technology is used around the legal rule in order to support it or help it, and therefore, indeed, there is a legal contract because the legal contract is inside the smart contract that then enforces it. On the other hand, we have the code is law approach, which is we are now able to create transactions which are smart contract transactions which do not at all have anything to do with the law, which do not require underlying legal rights because they are enforceable by themselves on the technical framework. And so we can forget for a moment about all the legal rule, contract law, etc., and just use the technology and design exactly the technical framework that we want to operate in. And so obviously there is like important difference between those two approaches in the sense that the legal contract is a rule that says what people should be allowed to do or not allowed to do, whereas smart contract is what people can or cannot do. So there is no way to avoid or to breach the rules that has been dictated by the smart contract. There is also the really important difference of the timing. So the legal contracts are enforceable only after the fact, so people are free to do whatever they like, and then comes the law and the third-party enforcement. If someone has done something wrong and has been sued, then they might be punished if they have been judged guilty, whereas in the case of smart contract, the enforcement comes beforehand. So people are actually constrained from acting according to the rules that have been dictated without having any chance to actually prove themselves that they actually did something that should have been considered right under the law. Really fast, the impact. So smart contracts do have some really positive impact on the legal system, most importantly for the efficiency. So currently, over 80% of a contract is never enforced simply because it's so expensive and it's only like the really people that really have a lot of stake that will actually enforce a contract. But all those smart contracts which are under the 10,000 euro threshold are not worth being enforced because it costs more to actually go to the court rather than enforce them. So in terms of transaction cost enforcement, it is really efficient to actually rely on technological smart contracts. However, the problem is that those smart contracts, because they cannot actually translate the same language of the law and because they cannot incorporate all the legal safeguards that are included in the law. So for instance, in the case of digital rights management system, there is all the concept of copyright exemption, of fair use, and et cetera, so private copying, pedagogical use, et cetera, which cannot be translated into a smart contract. So by default, a technological framework would just prevent any possible reproduction or communication to the public without being able to appreciate the law according to the case of according to the fact of the case in order to know whether or not to allow a particular use. And then there is, of course, the question of the law has to be interpreted and appreciated by a judge according to human values, according to mercy, the concept of equity, etc., which are simply forgotten whenever we get into a smart contract environment. And then there is the thing also, the question of like whether it is better or worse, perhaps it depends on the situation, to have ex ante versus ex post enforcement. There's the question of the law that is traditionally universal, so every rule should theoretically apply equally to everyone, whereas in the context of a contract and automated transaction, we can then design rules which evolve according to the person that they are interacting with. And so we lose the universality of the legal rules and we pass into a system where every rule is customized or personalized according to the individual, which completely changed the traditional principle of the legal system. And so to conclude, I will say that in the context of those new blockchain technologies, they provide fantastic opportunities for decentralized collaboration at a large scale. And I'm really eager to see distributed community to explore and to experiment with those new technology. But I will insist on two important points. The first one is that it is really dangerous to only delegate the concept of decentralized coordination to the code. And this has been seen, for instance, with Bitcoin. If we create a technology that is so decentralized and that is only relying on technological rules, then this technology is actually quite weak and it can be easily co-opted by centralized power, which, so we can see it with the mining pool, with the exchanges, etc. Because Bitcoin was not protected by an actual social layer or community layer, then it is really easy for whoever wants to just grab it and jump on it and then co-opt it according to their own interests. And the other one is that we have to also be careful when we use technology in order to regulate the behavior or to coordinate individuals. We also have to be conscious that the regulation by code has actually really different dynamics than traditional human or legal interaction. And so in the case, especially in the case of the centralized community, which are often grassroots and community driven, it is really important that we stay aware that how those technology might actually change the dynamics of those community because of all the efforts. I'm done. I have two answers. The first one is I'm Italian, or partially Italian, and we have this really common proverb, I would say, which is that rules are meant to be broken, which basically means that rules are designed to be broken. Legal rules are broad. They are, by definition, designed to be much broader than they should be, because we all know that you should not cross the road when the red light is there. But if you can see that there is not a car for like 10 kilometers, everyone is going to cross the road, right? But most importantly, there is, like, for instance, copyright law. Copyright law is a really broad regulation that says we should not reproduce, distribute, communicate to the public. But then there is, like, all this concept of, like, the fair use doctrine, which people know that there are situations in which this law will not be applied. But designing with, like, that's the really important trade-off between legal rules and formalized legal rules is that the law is by necessity flexible and ambiguous because it has to be interpreted by a judge and because it doesn't make sense to just, like, specify step by step and foresee every possible application. So we have those broad rules, and then there is the edge cases, and the edge cases is the interesting part where you don't know if it's going to be enforced or not, and then you need a judge to interpret, to appreciate the law according to the fact of the case. Absolutely. I mean, you take the risk. Yeah, you take the risk because you think this is a fair application, that you should be entitled to do that. And the copyright system is, the copyright law is the best example. On the internet, everybody is breaching copyright law because they don't believe in that law anymore. And then this is a sign that the law should evolve. Right? Now, if everything was under like a DRM, smart contract-based system, then you couldn't have this signal will not be visible. because no one will be able to actually breach the law, even though like all the fair use goes away, first of all, so the appreciation of the law doesn't exist anymore, but also the modification of the social framework cannot be expressed so that then the law cannot evolve accordingly. Well, I wouldn't say we shouldn't stop it in the sense that it actually has amazing opportunities as well, but we should be conscious of the fact that it has limits, and we should be really careful not to go beyond those limits, because otherwise it can turn into this like really oppressive system of self-enforcing.
Smart contracts, are they only can be used in blockchains, or is it a separate thing that can sit on anything?
So
blockchain fails as a technology. Can we use smart
Yeah, the smart contract is, but I mean, the smart contract is a thing. Smart contract doesn't mean anything. Smart contract is just a contract that is technologically enforced by a technology.
The technology is blockchain?
It doesn't have to be. Okay. I think the blockchain has shown a whole new wave of excitement for smart contract because it allows this trustless system. Because traditionally, there was all this discussion on like we want to create like trusted system. You know, like the computer that controls everything with digital right management everywhere. But it is like you need to trust the technology of the person that is doing it, right? Whereas in the blockchain, it's decentralized and it's trustless. And so you don't rely on any single entity that will decide what you can or cannot do. It is all transparent and it's all visible within the community. So there is this new interest. And I think the concept blockchain and smart contract has essentially been regarded in the context of a financial transaction because it's really simple. It's like automated financial transactions are really easy to implement. But I think it's really interesting to actually look broader in like the concept of how decentralized communities can use these decentralized technologies in order to coordinate themselves in a way that was really difficult before because somehow the decentralization is really difficult to coordinate and now the blockchain provides this coordination and this trustless enforcement of rules in a decentralized manner.
Just one quick comment. I think another application of smart contracts or blockchain in general is very interesting for communities. This whole name registration topic where there's
Namecoin, yeah.
Replaced,
absolutely.
One question, common point of criticism of all this blockchain stuff is also the use of resources. It burns up the earth, all this computation, so much energy.
I agree completely. It's like proof of work is completely crazy, but there is a lot of research that is being done now to identify new consensus mechanisms that are not based on proof of work and that do not require that craziness of computing resources. So hopefully, in a 6 year, 6 month, 1 year, maybe we actually have viable, scalable. Because the problem is this: the blockchain provides scalability for like large scale coordination, but then the blockchain itself right now is not scalable. I mean, the Bitcoin blockchain is like 20 gigabytes or something. It's just like going crazy.
I read somewhere that Ethereum is partnering with a company that produces electric heaters.
I don't know
how that
works. The
blockchain should be distributed in a way so you.
Yeah, well, that's where all the mining data centers are, yeah. The decentralized energy, right? Thank you.